Praise the Lord. I greet you in the name of our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. This is your program, Living by the Word. And of course, I'm yours truly, Pastor Hinds of Destiny Empowerment Global Ministry, the place where we are empowering the people to live the life that God wants us to live. I want to thank all of you, of course, who've been staying tuned to our programs, not just on the Tobago Inspirational Network, but of course, as well as on Facebook Live, where we are on Sunday mornings, 9:30 a.m. And of course, our Bible study during the week is on Tuesdays at 6:30 p.m. We are definitely looking forward to having seasons of prayer. Of course, that's going to be via Zoom, and stay tuned if you're interested in joining us to some of those seasons of prayer. You know, feel free to connect with us and get those information. Amen. So I trust that this word is reaching you in good health. I pray, God, that even as this word is spoken today, that your faith in God is going to be strengthened, that you're going to see difficult situations being turned around. You're going to see the hand of God upon your life in a mighty way. I pray as you continue to grow in faith, that, my God, you'll begin to believe, God, for things that seem impossible, because the word says, for with God, nothing shall be impossible. Amen. And the Bible says, all things are possible to them that believe. Amen. So today we continue talking about the life of faith. Amen. For the last couple of weeks, we've been talking about the life of faith, and we're going to continue to encourage us, because the Bible tells us in Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 4. It tells us in Galatians chapter 3, verse 11. In Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38. In Romans chapter 1, verse 17, that the just must live by faith. Let us pray. Father, thank you for your people. We thank you that the entrance of your word gives light, it gives understanding to the simple. Minister to those who will hear this word in the mighty name of Jesus. And all God's people says, amen. I've been talking to you about a life of faith. And of course, we've been looking at what faith is, amen, and what faith is not. And according to the passage of scripture, in Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1, I'm reading from the Good News Translation. It says, to have faith is to be sure of the things we hope for. It's to be certain of the things we cannot see. To have faith is to be sure of the things that we are hoping for. There are some things we are in expectancy about. There are some things that yet we have not been able to lay hold of. Faith actually is being sure about those things. Those things that are as yet have not been manifested. My God, we are not in doubt or concern or worry about them. Ah, God, the Bible says that faith is being sure about those things, though we have not yet experienced it. My God, it's just a matter of timing. It's not a matter of non-manifesting, so they're never going to happen. It's a matter that, hey, in the fullness of time, in due course, I will lay hold of the things that I am hoping for. It says it's to be certain of the things we cannot see. My God, there are many things that we are believing for. My God, are we not just, we're not seeing it? It doesn't mean because we don't see it, it doesn't exist. Faith lays hold of those things that we cannot see. My God, and faith lays hold of the things that we are yet in expectation for. Because if we can see those things, we don't need faith. If the thing we are hoping for is manifest, we don't need faith. But faith lays hold of them, my God, and gives us the assurance that we must experience all the things we are believing and hoping for if we continue to trust and hold on. Faith is a title deed, that is, or substance, which is the legal document constituting evidence of a right, especially to ownership of a property. They say faith works as a title deed. My God, you're not going to see the property that I have, but if I have the title deed, it is guaranteed, it is sure that I am the owner of the property once I have the title deed. And that's what faith is. My God, faith acts as the title deed to those things that we are believing God for. That's how powerful faith is. That's the assurance that faith gives.
Hallelujah. Faith speaks to what is hoped for. That is not wishful thinking. When we say things we are hoping for, it's not wishful thinking. That's what we say. But it is something that is certain, but yet not having fully realized in our present experience. So faith is speaking to those things that we are hoping for. In English language, we speak about, well, I hope so. But this is not what faith is. Faith is that guarantee that the thing we are hoping for, we are going to experience it in its season. Faith does not deny reality. In fact, I keep saying to you that it is our unfavorable reality that pushes us to trust God, where we cannot trust anything else. It's our unfavorable situations that when we sometimes find ourselves, my God, with our back against the wall, when like Moses, the enemy is after us and the Red Sea is in front of us and we do not know which way to turn, faith does not deny the reality. Faith now pushes us to call upon the one who is able to make a way where there seem to be no way. My God, I'm saying to you today, if you're looking at this program and your back is against the wall, you feel as though you're penned in, hemmed in, I am saying that's a good place for faith to be activated. Hallelujah. When you look around, you look to the left, you look to the right, you can't seem to find a way. Look up. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Look up. Jehoshaphat, when he found himself as a king with the armies coming against him and he had a whole nation to lead, Jehoshaphat knew where to look. He says, God, we don't know what to do, but there was a good place for faith in God to come into effect, to tap in the resources of heaven to get an answer in earth. And God did not disappoint. God says the battle is not yours. The battle is mine. The victory is yours. I'm saying to you, faith doesn't deny reality. Faith looks at reality, my God, and says, yeah, let me at it. You tried your senses. You tried working it out. You tried maxing it out. And it's not working. God, like the one with the issue of blood, she tried everything in the natural to get healing, to get her situation turned around. And then she heard about Jesus. Somewhere or the other, she heard. And she says, if I could just touch the hem of his garment, I would be made whole. Faith activates, my God, the miraculous in our situation. Then we know it is only God who had done it. That's what faith does. And we see faith being activated in the book of Hebrews. So many stories and testimonies of the saints of old. The Bible says, by it they gain a good report. Hallelujah. By it, by their faith in God, they gain a good report. Because without faith, he says, it is impossible to please God. For he that comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who will diligently seek him. Faith gave the elders a good report. Because they found themselves in difficult situation where the only way to turn was to God. Maybe that's what will happen with some of us. When we turn left, we turn right, and nothing is happening, we'll have no choice but to trust God. We'll have no choice but to say, Lord, I really don't know what else to do, but God, I'm going to trust you on this. Hey, let me tell you this. If you live long enough, life is going to come at you at such a pace that all the resources, all the wells in your life, God, even people that you're depending on and hoping that they're going to stand with you in difficult times, they are not there when you look for them. Don't be upset with them. Maybe God is just moving them out of the way that you can begin to look to him, that you can trust him, that your faith in him will be activated and be proven genuine. I said last time that Abraham's faith needed to be tested. My God, and God took him and told him, listen, go up on Mount Moriah, go to a place I will show you, and sacrifice your son there. And Abraham got up early and obeyed and went 3 days with that burden. with that responsibility, with that instruction, and carried his son Isaac. God carried the knife and got the wood and left the servants with the asses and went to obey God. And then the angel of the Lord says, hey, don't do it. God sees that you honor him. God sees that you reverence him. And God told him, don't do it. Amen. Because faith has to be tested. But I want to say to you today, as we continue with a life of faith, I want to say that faith is how we roll. Amen. The just shall live by faith. Faith is not situational and, well, I'm going to trust God here and I'm not going to trust God there. Faith is the modality of the child of God. We daily get up. We don't even know what the day holds. And we have to put on the mindset that today I am going to trust God in the big things, in the little things, in the important things, in the not so important things. I live by trust in God. That's why Paul, writing to the church in Corinth, he says we walk by faith and not by sight. God, we live our lives depending on God and trusting in God and not by what we see.
Yes, God, thank you.
That's how we live. Daily dependence on God. Daily conviction that God got my story handled. God got that situation worked out. God is for me. Then who can be against me? If God is on my side, then my God, no devil in hell will tamper with me and get away, because God is the one who's going to fight my battles for me. Every day I step out, it's a dependence on faith. Hallelujah. It's a dependence, a faith in God. That's what it is. But I'm saying to you today that faith needs action. Faith is not just talk. Faith is not just words. Faith is not just a concept that you have in your mind. Faith demands action. That's what I'm talking about today. We are in James chapter 2 from verse 14. To verse 26, it says, what doth it profit, my brethren, though a man may say he has faith and have not works? Can faith save him? Amen. And what he's talking about here, this can faith save him, he's saying, should be understood to mean, can a faith that does not express itself in good works be a saving faith? So it starts off there asking a question. Does a faith that does not express itself in good works be a saving faith? James is saying no. Amen. Can a say-so faith, come on, be a saving faith? He's saying no. I'm going to show you why. He says, because verse 15, if a brother or sister be naked and destitute of daily food, and one of you say to them, amen, depart in peace, be warmed, be filled, notwithstanding you give them not those things which are needful to the body, what does it profit? Verse 17, even so faith, if it hath not works, is dead, being alone. That's what he's saying. What he's talking about, faith. And if I want to bring greater clarity, I want to use the word believing alone. Hallelujah. Just something where we have this abstract belief alone. Yes, I believe God can do it. Yes, I believe you can be warmed and you can be comforted. But I am doing nothing to support my belief. He says that is not how faith is. He says, yes, you have faith, but it's a dead faith, hallelujah, that produces no results. Hallelujah. It is a dead faith. It's an impotent faith. Because faith is not just about a say-so. Faith is not just about words. Faith is action. Faith demands corresponding behavior or activity for it to be proven genuine faith. My God. Hallelujah. That is what we are saying. Thank you, Jesus. So he gives the example in verse 15. He says, giving a blessing to someone in need. So we just bless them. The Lord bless you. Amen. And without giving any tangible help is useless. That's what James is saying. Faith without any supporting action comes as though you just say, hey, the Lord bless you, the Lord keep. Just go with God. Be filled, be clothed, be warmed. And there is nothing tangible to cause those words to be manifest, or those words to take root, or those words to be effective. He said that is what faith is, being alone. It's just like telling somebody, be warm, be filled, be clothed, and there's nothing tangible for what you have spoken to manifest. That is how faith is, if it have no works. Come on, somebody. It's okay to say, well, I believe God that he will do such and such for me. But a belief alone with no supporting actions equal dead faith. That's all that James is saying. There must be appropriate action to support our belief. That is what will make our faith genuine. That's all he's saying. And then he goes down. Come on. He says, the works that we do, come on, is the evidence that your faith is genuine. That's why he says so. Verse 17 of James chapter 2, even so, faith, if it hath not works, is dead being alone. Faith alone cannot produce anything effective. Just like the words alone saying to somebody, be filled, be clothed, is not going to fill that person. Is not going to clothe that person. Try it and you will see. Tell the person, be clothed, be filled, and don't give them any supporting help. It's not going to be useful to that person. The words alone is not going to be useful. The words alone are not going to be effective in giving that person warmth and food and shelter if they're hungry. The words alone are going to be ineffective to bring about the result that you spoke. He says, that's how faith is. If it is just alone by itself, nothing to accompany the works, he says that faith is dead. But he doesn't talk about dead faith. He now talk about demonic faith. I want to talk about the demonic faith. He says, look at that, verse 18. Yea, a man may say, you have faith and I have works. Show me your faith without your works. I will show you my faith by my works. So you show me your faith and you have no works. He says, but if I truly do works, it is because I have the faith to do it. Come on, because faith cannot be seen. Hallelujah. You can't show me your faith if there is nothing to see, if there is no corresponding evidence. I need to see something to support this belief that you have. That's why he says, you will say, show me your faith without your works. I will show you my faith by my works. That is how faith is perfected. That is how faith is proven genuine, by the corresponding works that we do. And give an example. If you're looking for a job, amen, you can't just say, well, I believe that God will send a job for me, and there is no corresponding works. I sent out no application. I did not go out and talk to anybody. I made no calls. I typed no resume. I bought no clothes for an interview. I am just lying on my bed and I'm saying hallelujah, shandala, blah, 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 and I'm speaking in tongues and I'm praying and then I'm going back to sleep. That is faith without works. He says that kind of faith is dead. It's just faith alone with no works. That kind of faith is dead. He says, look at the demonic faith, verse 19 and 20. You believe that there is one God. You do well. The devils also believe and tremble. But wilt thou know, O vain man, that faith without works is dead? He says, even the demons believe. So when we believe, there is no difference, he says, than the demons. If you look at scripture, even Mark chapter 3, and you look at Matthew chapter 8, verse 29, when the demons saw Jesus, they identified him. They said to him, Jesus, thou son of David, have you come to torment me before my time? They recognize Jesus. They know who Jesus is. Amen. But they believe and they tremble. He says, that is not enough. Hallelujah. Believing is intellectual. Trembling is emotional. Amen. Let me just look at that passage of scripture. Matthew chapter 8. Thank you. Verse 29. Matthew chapter 8. Verse 29. It says from verse 28 of Matthew chapter 8. It says, and when he was come to the other side into the country of the Gergesenes, there met him two possessed with devils coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, so that no man might pass by that way. Verse 29. And behold, they cried out, saying, what have we to do with you, Jesus, you Son of God? Art thou come hither to torment us before the time? God, and the devils besought him. Come on. So they believe. They recognize Jesus for who he is. They besought him, saying, if you cast us out, suffer us to go away into the herd of swine. And Jesus said, go. And when they were come out, they went into the herd of swine. And behold, the whole herd of swine ran violently down a steep place into the sea and perished in the water. They recognized Jesus. Makira Messiah. The Bible says, two possessed with devils coming out of the tombs, exceeding fierce, that no man might pass that way. My God, they were so fierce that no human, my God, would pass that way. They avoided them altogether. But when they saw Jesus, they recognized him as the Son of God, equal with God in power, authority. Equality with God. They recognize Jesus for who he is, and they besought him. Now Jesus didn't have to be afraid of them. They recognized his authority and they besought him. Hallelujah. They said, have you come to torment us before the time? Recognizing who he was and besought him. My God, I like that word. If you can suffer us to go into the hood, they're not asking permission. It's, listen, if you take us out of here, we're asking you, amen, to send us into the herd of swine. They need a host. My God. But they recognize who Jesus is. And James saying, look, demons, they believe. And they tremble. They show some kind of emotion. Come on. Yes. So what is that? Amen. That is nothing, because that is not any genuine faith. They believe, they tremble, but they're not saved. Hallelujah. They believe, they tremble, and they still continue to live as demons and devilish. There's no change. My God, because just belief alone and an emotional response is not enough to get anybody saved. Not the devils and not you. There are many people you talk to, yes, they believe in Jesus. They will tell you that, my God, and they may hear a sermon and get some kind of emotional response, but still they are not yet saved, because that alone will not save. They need to take appropriate action. Romans 10, 9 and 10 says, if we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in our heart that God has raised him from the dead, you will be saved. We need to take appropriate action. Just belief and trembling alone does not equal salvation, does not equal change. Many people are like that. They have a demonic type of faith. Yes, they get emotional when they hear the word. My God, and then they leave and go back as if they never heard anything. My God, they love to listen to good sermons and good preaching, but they're not coming to the place of trusting Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior, surrendering their hearts to him and turn from their wicked ways. They're not coming to that place. So there is belief, there is trembling. But that's not good enough. But look at what the Bible says. Verse 21. Was not Abraham our father justified by works when he had offered Isaac his son upon the altar? Seest thou how faith wrought with his works, and by works. Look at that. By works was faith made perfect. What perfects our faith or shows a mature kind of faith is the works that accompany the faith. That's what we're saying. Faith needs action. Hallelujah. I preached a sermon a while back, says faith needs feet. Hallelujah. Otherwise, it's just sitting there immobile, doing nothing. It needs accompanying action. And he says, look at Abraham. When Abraham had to offer his son Isaac, my God, on Mount Moriah, Abraham did not sit in a corner and say, yes, I believe God. Hebrews tells us that the reason he did it is because he believed God was able to raise him up again from the dead. He believed that. But he didn't stay at home with Isaac and say, well, I believe God, and just do nothing. He went ahead and he actually offered Isaac his son up on the altar. That was the corresponding work that was necessary to prove his faith genuine. And as the word of God says, by the works, the deeds he did, his faith was made perfect. Ah, God, we need to have a perfected faith. And it's not going to be just by a say-so alone, or just by a believe and tremble alone, but by the appropriate actions that we take that support the belief that we have in God that will perfect that faith. And the scripture was fulfilled with said, Abraham believed God, and it was imputed unto him for righteousness, and he was called a friend of God. You see then how that by works, verse 24, a man is justified and not by faith alone. And don't get, and you know, you might be thinking, well, Paul writing that we're not justified by the works, but Paul was talking about the works of the law. Amen. James is talking about the appropriate deeds that perfect the thing we are believing for. Amen. Just like Abraham and Sarah, God gave them a promise that they were going to have a son. If Abraham and Sarah just said, hey, we're going to have a son and do nothing, they would never have birthed Isaac. They needed to come together and do what big people do in order to prove that their faith in God to bring forth this son was genuine. That's what we're talking about. Faith is not just say so. Verse 25 says, and time is gone. Likewise also, was not Rahab the harlot justified by works when she had received the messengers and had sent them out another way? Verse 26, for as the body without the spirit is dead, so faith without works is dead also. We must have the corresponding works to perfect our faith and to prove our faith is genuine. And I pray that when you say you trust God for whatever it is you're trusting God for, you will take the corresponding and appropriate action to perfect that faith and get the desired results. Amen. And of course, this is all the time we have for Living by the Word. I want to encourage you to learn the Word, love the Word, live the Word. Till next time, stay strong. God bless you. Bye-bye.